A system can be described in two broad ways, in logical terms and in physical terms. A logical description, historically we've often called that a functional description, articulates what the system will do, how well it will do it, how it will be tested, under what conditions it will perform, and what other systems will be involved with its operation. A physical description relates to the system elements themselves. It explains what those elements are, how they look, how they'll be manufactured, how they'll be integrated, and how they'll be tested. So a logical description is about what, and a physical description is about how. But both those descriptions, of course, are very important, and they both exist together. And both of them require what we call later a series of statements called requirements. Now, the two descriptions are valid, independent descriptions of the system, and it's very important that the system is described both logically and physically. But of course, we must focus first on the logical description. Now, in one sense, it's axiomatic that we develop that logical description first in order to determine whether any particular physical system is appropriate, that is, how we're going to do it is useful to us. We must first understand, of course, what it is we want to do. What purpose do we want the system to serve? We therefore need to focus on the logical description, the what, before we examine a series of candidate physical descriptions, the hows, of how we might develop the system, one of which, of course, is going to be chosen as our preferred physical solution. The second reason is we must also not allow the way in which we currently implement current systems to colour unnecessarily the way in which we describe future systems. If we focus on the logical description, we can then focus on perhaps novel solutions to new or even old problems. If we focus on the physical solution first, we would always end up solving new problems with the old physical building blocks. Third, if we're going to trade things off, if we're going to actually trade off value for money, for example, then we need to do that at a logical level before deciding on the physical implementation. If not, we may waste significant effort selecting physical solutions which either perform unnecessary functions or don't perform something which actually is critical. Next, a logical description is ideally suited to the interface between systems engineering and the business case. While it's often possible for the business case to be met directly by an obvious physical solution, it's probably better for business management to transition from their business case into a more detailed logical description before going on to deciding how to solve that problem in a physical sense. The definition of the logical description before the development of a physical system therefore moves from the business case to the final solution in a more controlled, more verifiable way. And the final reason is that the logical description changes much more slowly. The physical description changes very quickly, particularly these days with changes in technology. Arguably, for example, the need for and the upper level description of an internal combustion engine hasn't changed much over the last two centuries. Its purpose is to provide forward motion for the car. But the physical implementation for an engine has changed dramatically. That is, the purpose of the system as part of the car hasn't changed, but the way in which we do it has, as we avail ourselves of new technology. In the development of a system, therefore, there are the two architectural views, a system logical architecture and a system physical architecture. Now, of course, these two descriptions are of the same system, so they must be related. We'll see later how the logical architecture, as outlined in the requirements breakdown structure, is mapped onto the physical architecture as it's represented in what we call the work breakdown structure. We saw earlier that a system can be defined as the combination of system elements which interact to achieve a defined mission. Now, since each of these system elements will need to perform functions that have been allocated to it so it can contribute to the system's mission, we can consider a system to be a hierarchical composition of system elements. In a logical description of a system, the system's mission is broken down into a hierarchical structure of its major functions. The logical description or architecture is therefore often called a functional hierarchy or a functional architecture. In a physical sense, we saw earlier that a system can be considered to comprise operational or end products and enabling products. The end products of the system are also normally described in a hierarchy. Here we use a simple four-layer hierarchy. We can say that the top-level thing is the system, and it comprises subsystems, each of which comprise a number of assemblies, each of which comprise a number of components. And this then forms a physical hierarchy of the system. There are other terms in use, but these are probably the most common. The application of these terms to specific situations and different examples also depends very much on the context of the situation and where within the overall project the system is being considered. For example, if we take the highest level of an aircraft system, we could consider that an aircraft contains, amongst other things, an engine subsystem, and that would comprise assemblies such as fuel tanks, pumps and lines, turbines, compressors, gearbox and hydraulic pumps and so on. Now, from the viewpoint of an engine manufacturer, however, the engine could be considered to be a system, and it comprises fuel, power plant, hydraulic subsystems, and so on. The problem is, however, if we consider the engine subsystem to be a system in its own right, an implicit part of the definition of a system is it has to be able to stand on its own. By that definition, an engine is not able to be considered a system. It's only useful as an element of a system, that is, as a subsystem. It's probably better, therefore, to consider a system of interest to comprise a combination of interacting system elements, some of which may be systems in their own right. When the system of interest consists of only system elements that are systems in their own right, the system of interest is called a system of systems. Now, a system of systems has a similar architecture to that of a system. That is, both comprise elements that are interconnected. But there is a difference. And the difference is that the system of system elements are systems in their own right, so that they're managerially independent and operationally independent, and have probably been optimized for their own purposes before contributing to the purpose or the mission of the system of systems. Now, on the other hand, if we take the system, the subsystems in a system are not independent and only exist to serve the parent system. Subsystems are therefore invariably not optimal from their own perspective. That is, they could be better. But it's the system that needs to be optimized, not the subsystems. We'll return to this issue later. The distinction between systems as element of a system of systems and subsystems as elements of a system is therefore that the system of system comprises systems that have been optimized for their own purposes before joining the system of systems. On the other hand, a system comprises elements, the subsystems, that are not optimized for their own purpose, but have been optimized for the system's purpose. From the higher level perspective then, a system of systems is most likely not optimized because the elements, the systems, were first optimized for their own purpose before joining that system of systems. Now, system of systems and systems, the distinction becomes quite blurred. So in this course, we'll leave it alone. We're focusing on systems whose elements are all subsystems, systems that are systems genuinely in their own right. We can complete our introduction to the nature of systems by returning to one of the early observations that a system can be considered to be the solution of a problem. As well as viewing the system descriptions in logical and physical terms, therefore, it's common to consider the activities being undertaken throughout the life of the system to be either in the problem domain, the problem space, where we use mainly logical descriptions, or the solution domain, or the solution space, where we use mainly physical descriptions. We'll see later that the activities in the problem domain, including the production of the logical architecture, are mostly the responsibility of the customer or the business owner. The solution domain, including the development of the physical architecture and the physical solution, are generally considered to be the responsibility of the organization who's developing the system, and we call them the developer. So now we've completed our brief introduction to systems. In the next presentation, we'll look briefly at the life cycle of a system, before we turn our attention to the principal focus of the course, systems engineering.